Hey, this is Joe Jack Talcum from the Dead Milkmen, and you're watching Crash and Bleed. It's Friday night, cooking show with a horse meat dish. I had to stay in the freezer all Thursday eating. Talk to that horse, really had to go. Down to the sidewalk, the sky is all red, and the streets filled with people. From a high school band, I escaped to a theater to see a girl with long blonde hair, right down to there. I escaped to a theater to see a girl with long blonde hair. We had to leave. Got into a tan van, us two in the back, with Steve McGarrett from a Y5O at the steering wheel. Speeding away, we slide into a parking lot, but all in slow motion. These tough guys appear. We argue and fight, and one pulls at 90. It's me in the back, but I'm all right. I'm alright, I'm alright, I'm alright.
He's alright.
I escaped to a theater to see a girl with long blonde hair right down to there. I escaped to a theater to see a girl. I saw you were drumming. I didn't hear it though.
So, Joe.
Mm-hmm.
You're in the legendary punk rock band, the Dead Milkmen.
Oh yeah?
Yeah, and you've been going for over 40 years now, if you count like the imaginary start to the band before it became a real band. 40 years a band. Does it feel like you're in a legendary band at this point?
It doesn't really even seem that long because we took a long break. In fact, I didn't even know we were taking a break. We broke up.
Yeah.
It's kind of fantastic to me sometimes to think of what happened, that we got back together with Dan. But yeah.
I didn't want to talk too much about the story of how the band started because that's all pretty well documented. People can go look that up. You've talked about it to death. So I
yes.
wanted to talk more about the obscure side of the band that maybe people don't know about. But firstly, I wanted to get into what it was like growing up for you before you started playing music.
Well, it seemed like it was a normal time. Growing up in the late 60s and early 70s, before I played music, I spent a lot of my time listening to music. I didn't really play sports growing up, organized sports, not that I didn't like being active, but I just wasn't that good at it. And it just seemed like music was my thing from an early time.
And what were some of the first bands that you ever discovered?
The Partridge Family, they were a TV band. They weren't an actual band, but I didn't really discover them. I think they were already discovered. I got a book in school about the band The Birds. So I found out about them. The reason I got the book, it came with a record, and I liked records a lot. So I learned about The Birds. I liked them. The record had four songs by The Birds on it. Two of those songs were by Bob Dylan, and he was also mentioned in this book. It was a book put out by Scholastic Books. So I was introduced to The Birds through that, and also through Bob Dylan at the same time. I was in the seventh grade, I think it was. So I would have not been quite a teenager yet, I think. But Also in the eighth grade, I got a book out of the library about the band The Beatles, because they were also, of course, how could you escape The Beatles at that point in time? But they were mentioned in the Birds book as being very influential. And this book was, I remember it well, it was by Hunter Davies. It was a biography of The Beatles. From there, I sought out Beatles records from the library. I borrowed some. My aunt had some. So those were the first things I liked, was Bob Dylan, the Beatles, and the Birds, and other British invasion bands I started getting into. Along came the Ramones. I heard them on the radio, and they kind of rocked my world. By then, I was in high school, and I think I found my calling when I heard the Ramones. I was like, I want to be in a band just like that. Before that, I wanted to be in a band just like the Beatles, but I didn't think that in the 70s, any band that was like the Beatles would ever be taken seriously by anybody, because it was so has been. But the Ramones, to me, they were something new and exciting. They represented punk rock music.
Did you have many friends at that time?
I had a couple. I didn't have many, but I had my neighbor Garth, who he was a fantastic friend of mine. Really liked hanging out with him and spending time. And there was another friend of mine named Randy, who was met me in school. He befriended me in the ninth grade, and lo and behold, what we had in common was he was also a Beatles fan. I didn't know anybody else who liked the Beatles as much as I did, except for him. So we were nerdy fans of the Beatles. He also liked sci-fi stuff like Star Trek and whatnot. So we had a lot in common, and we liked to go see movies together. But I don't think he liked punk rock as much as I did. I also tried to get him into liking Bob Dylan as much as I did, because I thought Bob Dylan was something beyond anything else.
Can you remember what the first punk rock record you ever bought was?
It had to have been Rocket to Russia. I'm almost certain of it. I ordered a record through the mail that had some punk rock, had Sex Pistols on it, but it was a compilation album put out by Warner Brothers Music over here in the United States as a way to promote their I think it was called Troublemakers. It was to promote their, I guess, new wave punk rock bands in the late 70s. Wire was on that. That's the first time I heard Wire, and I really fell in love with that band. Gang of Four, first time I heard Gang of Four. So besides that, I think it was the Ramones, Rocket to Russia. It's hard for me to get them in exact order, but I got, I bought a Wire record, Pink Flag. I bought B-52's first album. I bought Devo, Freedom of Choice, and then also their first album, Are We Not Men? I considered all this punk back at the time. I bought Blondie. I thought that was their first couple albums influenced me a lot. Talking Heads, is that considered punk? I bought their couple albums by them. These were all The Clash. How can I not forget The Clash? I got their Green album. That was what I guess it was called over here. It wasn't exactly like the UK version, but I loved it. Eventually, I got the Sex Pistols too. They were already broken up, and I kind of considered them not something I should concern myself with because they were broken up. But once I did get their album, I thought, wow, this is pretty amazing stuff.
So that was all in the 70s, so you were basically there from the very beginning?
1979, 1980, we're talking the end of the decade.
Yeah, did you teach yourself to play guitar?
Yes. I taught myself from chord shapes. I bought a book of Bob Dylan songs, and they had chord shapes in them. Probably not the ones he was playing. It was probably somebody else wrote it out and said, this is how you play a D. They're typical. The typical open chords, like D, D7, G, G7. And then my next big step was learning bar chords so I could play more like Johnny Ramone. The power chord.
Was this like a decision that you had to make to not use distortion in those early days? Because there wasn't a hell of a lot of that going on for you, was there?
It was a decision I made because I didn't have any distortion. My first two guitars were acoustic. They weren't even electric. So when I did get an electric guitar, that was something new. I did acquire a Big Muff distortion box, and I brought it. This is after Dean joined the band, and we were a real band, and Rodney was in the band and everything. I was playing with that, and Dean told me to turn it down or turn it off because he couldn't understand when I was making my chord changes. I guess it was just too distorted. It was everything was too, I didn't know how to control it, I guess. And after that, I just didn't bring it again. I just decided I was just going to play clean. So Dean could hear the chord changes for one thing, and then it became my sound. Other people reacted to it, and then it just fed on itself. It's like, well, then that's the way it is.
Did you find yourself getting into the hardcore bands that were coming out in the early 80s?
I did. I moved to college in the end of 1980. I didn't know anything about hardcore until I guess, let me try to think when I first heard Black Flag. And I think it was somebody had at college had my friend Kurt Brenneman. He was a friend I met first year of college. He's the first guy. He first played the Velvet Underground to me because I'd read the name, but I never heard their music. I'd heard Nico. I heard Lou Reed, of course. And he also, and I was like, this guy has a great record collection. I just spent hours in his dorm room listening to records. He had a record called Let Them Eat Jelly Beans. It was, I think it was put out by Jello. It was a Dead Kennedys thing. Oh, and the Dead Kennedys. I heard them too. Then it was my second semester of college. But it had Bad Brains on it. And I just thought that's probably the first thing I heard that was anything like hardcore punk. And then I started hearing more things like that. It was just the fastest thing. And also the Dead Kennedys second album, it was an EP, In God We Trust. Those are the two things that I remember. And I wanted to emulate that. And by this point, Rodney and I were recording stuff together in my bedroom when I came home from college. That after that semester coming home from college, that's all I wanted to do was try to come up with songs that were super fast and hardcore.
Well, let's talk a little bit about how you first met Rodney, because I don't think the world knows that story. Maybe a few people do.
Well, in public school here, for some reason, I don't know who made this rule, but in our school, wherever you sat for lunch the first day in school, you had a lunch period. We had like three lunch periods, and they were assigned to you by the school. You didn't pick them. Is based on when, you know, how your class schedule went. So you'd go in the lunchroom and everyone's nervously looking around, or maybe they have friends already and they're sitting with them. But I didn't have any friends in my lunch period that I knew, because I only had a couple of friends and they were in different lunch periods. So I just sat somewhere, and it happened to be at the table Rodney sat with some other people, and we became, that's where we sat for the rest of the semester. For lunch every time. And I didn't know Rodney. Rodney didn't know me. But I got to know him just from having lunch every day, Monday through Friday. And he was just the fun. He was like the center of attention at our table.
Was he mischievous? Did he get up to no good?
Yeah, he was mischievous. But at least in the way he tells the stories, he was. And he was on journalism. He was in the journalism class with my best friend and neighbor, Garth. I wasn't in that class. I was in the electronic journalism, which was the TV class, because I wanted to be on TV. That was my goal before I wanted to be in a musician, was to be on TV and to do funny comedy things, like maybe be a a TV writer, or maybe it'd be a TV comic. But Rodney was really the TV comic. When I saw him, he was like acting like a little Johnny Carson doing stand-up routines every afternoon at lunch. He heard, I made a tape with Garth called So Long 70s that was branded as the Dead Milkmen, and Garth passed this tape around. Like we made a cover for it and made it look like a real cassette, or tried to. And Rodney heard it. He lent it to Rodney. Rodney heard it, and he came to me after school while we were waiting for our buses and said, "Yeah, I heard this tape, So Long 70s. It's brilliant. When's your next recording session? How can I be a part of it? I play banjo." And I said, "Really?" I wasn't even thinking there would be another recording session. But right then, on the spot, for some reason, I said, "How does next Saturday sound?" And we exchanged information, and he came over with his banjo, and lo and behold, and another of my neighbors and Garth, we're all together. We set this all up, and we just ad-libbed songs. And the brilliant thing is that Rodney just, I think he just came up with lyrics on the spot to chord progressions that we were coming up together with. And we made a tape that became the seed of the second tape we did called Folk Songs for the 80s. The whole idea of the Dead Milkmen was that, of course, they were the terrible combination of punk and folk music. So it would be folk punk, and it wasn't supposed to work, but it somehow did. Rodney became a part of the band and became a part of the fictitious story after that. And we made some more tapes together. That's the way we kind of fell into writing songs together. Rodney was kind of the lyric guy, and I was kind of the music guy. He still would come up with music ideas and music as well, and I would come up with lyric ideas and lyrics as well.
Can he still play banjo to this day?
He didn't really play the banjo like anybody normally would, but I guess so. I guess he could still play it that way. Like, for example, the song Rastabilly from the first album, he wrote on banjo. Those are notes he picked out on banjo at the time, and just had the song that goes that way. And then I just came up with chords to do the other part, the non down. So that was supposed to be a combination of rockabilly and reggae. It didn't really end up that way, but that's what it was supposed to be.
So in the early days of the band, it sounded like you were kind of the lead vocalist. We heard a little bit of Rodney, but by the time the first album came out, it was like all Rodney, and you had like one and a half songs. Could you talk about why he sort of took the lead vocals?
I sang more of the songs than Rodney did at first. There was a period of time after Dave joined the band, and we still weren't a real band, but I met Dave at college, and he and I started writing songs together too, and we started writing music. And Rodney didn't go to college where I did. I went to college in Philadelphia. He sent us lyrics through the mail, and we would put music to them. Dave and I would read his lyrics and come up with music to, after the lyrics were already written, come up with music to them. And Rodney, I would sing them and record them and play them for Rodney next time I met him. And he was fine with that arrangement for the most part, but he did play drums with us on some recordings, but Dave didn't think he was up to snuff with keeping a beat. So we started auditioning behind Rodney's back. We didn't tell him I was still at college. We started auditioning drummers, and the second one was Dean, and we thought he was perfect, and Dean wanted to be in the band. And Dean got us a gig literally 2 weeks after he joined the band, and Rodney still didn't know about it. I had written Rodney a letter explaining that we were going to hire Dean as the drummer, and he wrote back and was fine about that. I guess he was a little like, oh, I still have the letter somewhere. So you're replacing me as the drummer, then, you know, what can I am I still going to write? I still wanted him to write lyrics, but quickly I had to make a decision because I didn't expect to have a gig so fast, but Dean got one through his friend John. Dean had been in a band before that too, that they had kind of broken up suddenly. And I was sort of suspicious. Maybe this was a gig that was meant for his other band and we were just replacing them, but I don't really know. We wanted to play, Dave especially wanted to play the gig. So I had to get a hold of Rodney, and there's no cell phones back then. And no one was, he had a dorm room cell phone, a dorm room payphone, but it was hard to get in touch with him. I finally got in touch with his mom to call me back, and it was like maybe the Thursday before the show was supposed to happen. I'm saying, Rodney, we have it. Do you want to sing our songs? And it's like this was literally like 3 days before the show. He came to Philly that Friday, and the show was Saturday, and we went through a whole list of the songs that he wrote half the lyrics, so he already knew them. And I think Dean couldn't come with us to practice that Friday, but Dave was with us. Dave and me and Rodney just went through the songs acoustically, and the next day was when the whole band got together for the first time with Rodney singing, and it was at the show. And it worked out pretty well. So we knew that that was the way it was meant to be. That's the story of Rodney really came into the band.
So in the early days of the band, did you ever find yourselves crossing paths with like some of the big hardcore bands at the time, like maybe the Descendants? Did you ever play with the Misfits?
I saw the Misfits, but we didn't play with them. I saw the Misfits play at a really small club in Philly that I got snuck into because I wasn't of age. I remember, I think we played a show with Iron Cross. We played a show with the Minutemen. Yeah, we opened up for the Minutemen before our first album came out. We were only known in Philly pretty much at that time. That was pretty incredible. We played a couple shows with Husker Du opening for them. They were a big favorite of mine. We opened up for the Circle Jerks. That was fun. We also opened up for the Ramones once, but this was after we started. We had a couple tours under our belt, and it was I think it was their first Chicago show with CJ Ramone in the band. So that was interesting. We did open up for Black Flag. Not Black. Was it Black Flag? It might have been Black Flag. I don't remember now. There was a big hardcore show on one of our first tours in California. I remember that.
Did you find that the hardcore crowd embraced your band?
The crowd did. I think we were instantly entertaining to the hardcore crowd. There were certain bands in Philly that thought we should go away. I won't mention any names. I don't even think any of those bands are around anymore, but there was a serious side of the punk scene in the early 80s. That didn't appreciate our mocking nature, but that's just who we were. In fact, I remember we wanted to be on this punk compilation, this hardcore compilation that came out of Philly, but we were denied. FOD always liked us. We always got along with them, but they always had a good sense of humor.
So who would you have said was the most iconic punk rocker?
The most iconic for me probably is Johnny Rotten.
Do you think you guys would get along if you met?
Probably not. I'm not really good at meeting icons. I'm sure he's just like a regular person. I'm sure we'd get along okay. We did meet the Damned, and they were a lot nice. They were gentlemanly.
Was that Rodney's favorite band back then?
I think they were. I think the Damned were up there high on the list. I do remember trying to go see the Damned, and my fake ID got caught, and I wasn't allowed in. But my friends were already in, and I had to just walk around waiting for the show to be over.
So just in case I never get an interview with Dean, could you tell us about where he came from, like where his musical influences were?
Dean, from what I now know, liked prog rock first. I guess that's when he first became a drummer. He was into bands like Yes and Emerson, Lake and Palmer, maybe Genesis, I don't know. And then he got in punk, probably around this, I'm imagining around the same time that I did. And he joined a duo called Narthex, who, interestingly, I saw play a basement show when I was in college. I didn't know it back then that he would be in a band with me, but I like them. They were a two-piece guitar and drums, and the guitarist also sang. I met him in college because he sat in on one of our, he was a friend, a best friend of somebody I was in college with in our radio, television, film introduction class, where it was our production class where we got to have fun and make little TV skits and be both in front of the camera and behind the camera and do everything that you're, you know, need to do to make a TV show. He came to some of those classes as just a guest. That's really the first time I met Dean. When we found out that his band Narthex broke up, that's when we invited him to, because he was looking for another band, try out for us. And we had already had a bunch of songs written. I didn't really know him that well. I mean, we had a part. He was at one of our Christmas parties that Dave and I threw. Dave and I very briefly lived in the same house together in Philadelphia. We rented a low rent, three-story row house. And we threw a Christmas party. The guy that became our Dead Milkmen's manager was one of Dean's best friends. He was the guy who was in the class, in the radio TV production class with me. So that's how I know Dean.
So let's talk a little bit about Dave Blood in those early days. Dan says he was a lot older than you, wasn't he?
6 years older. That is a lot older when you're a teenager, I must admit. But his brother was exactly my age. His brother went to college with me. But his brother was a punk rocker from head to toe. He dressed like one, and he had a great record collection. And I saw him moving in with his crates of records in the elevator. And I made a point. I mean, I was too shy to say anything right then and there, but I made a point to get up because I was a shy person. I made a point to get up enough courage to approach him. And eventually I did approach him probably in the cafeteria and introduce myself. And we got to be friends. And he turned me on to a lot more punk music, more indie music that I didn't know about, including the Zero Boys and Dow Jones and the Industrials, bands from the Midwest. Back then in the United States, every little town would have its own punk scene and bands that were regionally known, but they weren't all necessarily known across the United States. And they would put out records on independent record labels. So that was one way of getting in. Now, those bands, when I mentioned to Joe that I would love to be in a performing band, and I had already played some of the Dead Milkmen stuff for him. He told me his brother plays bass and was looking for a band, and so it might be a good fit. And he invited his brother over to the dorm rooms to meet me. And I remember his brother brought over a bottle of gin and snuck it in the dorm rooms. And so I was too young to drink, but I had a few drinks with him when the first time we met, kind of like an icebreaker, and we hit it off pretty well. We even wrote a song, so that's how I knew that he would work out with me. We wrote a song called "I Don't Wanna, I Don't Wanna." It was like a Ramones ripoff.
Did he teach himself to play?
One of the main guys from Dow Jones and the Industrials gave Dave his first bass lesson. First bass lessons. But he was mostly self-taught, Dave. We were learning, as I was still learning a lot. I still had a lot. I always have a lot to learn on guitar. I still do. But we were kind of figuring it out together. How bass and guitar go together.
Would you say he invented that style of playing?
Did Dave invent his style of playing? Did Dave invent... I guess Dave had a very unique approach to bass. So, but we both like the Beatles. Dave and I both like the Beatles. And interestingly, Dean and Rodney both dislike the Beatles. So we had that dynamic in our band. But what I envied of him, of Dave, was that he was a teenager during the 60s when a lot of the music I liked happened, but I liked it a generation away, and he was there at the beginning of it. And he was like buying singles in that era, whereas I was buying singles in the mid-70s. So yeah, I guess he probably did invent a lot. He had a unique style, just like I had a unique style of how I played guitar.
If you want to pick up that guitar and play a song, you just pick it up, man.
Right.
So, are there any people from those early hardcore days that you've kept in touch with?
Not really. They're. I mean, we just played a show with a lot of these, with two of those hardcore bands, FOD and Y Die, and it was great to reconnect with those people. But to say I was surprised that they have adult children now. I don't have any kids, but it was great to catch up with them and hear about where they are in their lives and all the stuff that they've done. But I didn't keep up with any of those people in the meantime. Probably I lost touch by the 90s. Definitely after the Dead Milkmen broke up and everybody was sort of doing their own thing.
Well, let's talk about some of the more iconic Dead Milkmen tracks then. Maybe some fan favorites and deep cuts. But before we get into that, does Rodney really hate the early stuff? Because on Big Questions, he makes it sound like he can't stand any of the early recordings.
He writes all of our set lists, and he's the one that puts them in. He wants to play them. His concern is that we provide a valuable entertainment to the audience, and he knows the audience likes them. He's a pretty good judge of what a crowd wants and what a crowd needs. I think at the time he was way into them. He just seemed genuinely, I don't think he hated them at the time, or else he wouldn't have been a part of it. But it might make you think that he did retrospectively, but I don't think he did.
Would you consider the song Tiny Town to be a fan favorite, or is it kind of a deep cut now because it's in the past?
Yeah, I guess that's a fan favorite. The record company that put out, Fever Records, that put out our album, almost put that out as an introductory single, but they, because of budget reasons, they didn't.
So what would you say is your favorite track from the first album?
Rossibility.
Really?
Yes, that's my favorite. I like the way that one came out.
It's one of the funniest songs on the album as well. I love. Was that improvised at the end, the whole cough syrup thing?
Yes. It was, and we overdubbed stomping, and we wanted to make it sound like a rowdy. We wanted it to sound improvised, more improvised than it really was.
It's one of the greatest tracks from the early days, definitely. But could you talk a little bit about that song Gorilla Girl? Because Dan mentioned that one.
Oh, yeah. That wasn't even supposed to be on the first album. Dave and I wrote that. That was in one of our first times we got together to write songs. One of our first ever times. And I brought Dave out to the suburbs so he could see where I grew up. He had a car. I didn't have a car back then, but he did. It was an old green Chevrolet, 1972, I think it was. The car was. This is the year was 19, probably 1982. Yeah. So, and a 20-year-old, 70, 10-year-old car. It seemed a lot older to me, but it, the car seemed older to me. Not Dave. Dave was 6 years older to me, and I looked up to him, like sort of like an older brother almost. We sat down to write a song, and we wanted it all. We wanted G to be our inspiration. The letter G and the chord, the key signature G. Is that called alliteration? I forget where we wanted G or G sounds. No, G sounds. So that's why Gorilla Girl was the title, and Golf Pro is G, and Gobs. There's a lot of G. In other words, there's a lot of G words in the lyrics, and that was pretty much the inspiration for the song.
I never knew that.
He did this little do 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 do, and I thought, oh, that sounds like a little reggae kind of ska thing. And I always like ska music. So
Yeah.
that's the story behind that song. We wrote it really quickly too, and we were like trading verses. It's one of those things we did. He'd write a line, he'd write a rhyme, I'd write a rhyme, he'd write a rhyme, I'd write a rhyme, till we had it done.
Let's get into that song Serrated Edge then, because I think it's safe to say you guys never really dropped that from the live set, did you?
No, Rod. Yeah, that's another crowd favorite. That song came about musically first. I went over to Dave's apartment. Dave and I lived together at first, but we could only stand 6 months, I guess, of each other, and he had to move out into his own. He had to move out in his own space. I wouldn't say it was necessarily because of me, but we had other housemates too. Probably because he was so much older and more, and we were just immature kids. He had to move out. He didn't want to be our daddy. He moved out into his own apartment, but he had this little riff. That was the riff to the serrated edge bass line. And I thought, that's really cool. I can play this against it. But he had nothing else. He said, how do we make this into a song? So I just had, oh, well, what is it? Well, another part could just start on, instead of start on E, it could just start it's not in the key of E, but we can put D there because it's in the key of A. That's a neat little trick. We could do that. He said, yeah. And then we came up with a third part, and then we had a song. We just arranged it. We did this a lot, just arranging songs like you would to be songs, but they didn't have any lyrics, and we took that then into practice with the demo. We were already banned by this time. We were playing shows. Rodney had lyrics by the end. I always remember Rodney coming up with lyrics so fast that it was hard to imagine how he could do that. But even if he didn't have all the lyrics, he had enough of them so that we already knew the song was going to be a dead looking song. And by the next practice, it was called Serrated Edge, and all the lyrics were there, and they were hilarious. Where Rodney gets this idea, Diaz, or got the idea for that, I don't know. But the whole idea of Charles Nelson Reilly being the savior is funny, and it made it onto the first album. It was also one of the newer songs, because a lot of the songs on the first album were predated the band being a real band.
So could you talk us through the inspiration for the beach song? I always loved like how you had the smooth, groovy, mellowed out verses, and then the more exciting, aggressive punk rock choruses with the silly lyrics, you know?
I literally was with my family, my parents, at the beach, and I would have rather been home at my bedroom recording songs. So I wrote that while I was at the beach, saying I didn't want to be there. And I was thinking of all the reasons I didn't want to be there. They're ne not necessarily true reasons, but I was just making up a song. So,
Yeah.
and the no fun part, or at least the way I had the other part, that was actually inspired by the Sex Pistols' No Fun. but it, I don't think it in the original final version it doesn't play that way.
I mean, if you get the reference, it kind of makes sense though, right? I mean, but moving on to that song Plum Dump, I could never work out what the lyrics were supposed to be about with that song. Can you talk us through the creation of that one?
That one I wrote during my first semester at college. One of our classes, I think it was a sociology class that I had, the teacher was this guy that, interestingly enough, Dave Blood also had as a teacher, because we compared notes later on when I found out he went to the same school I did, but 6 years previous. But the guy had, in one of his lectures, he was talking about aphrodisiacs, or what were perceived as aphrodisiacs, like Spanish fly, that was the one that he specifically mentioned. And for some reason, that was inspiration, lyrical inspiration for me to just come up with this crazy idea that somebody could, that plums could be aphrodisiacs in this strange world that I created for the song. So that literally was the inspiration. So I wrote a song. How could I write a story about that that had a unique aphrodisiac? And I wrote the song in my head musically because I didn't bring my acoustic guitar to college with me on my first semester, which was in hindsight a mistake, because then I had to think of songs only and not actually figure out. So I was like, I can't wait till I get home for break, because I have this whole song that's going around in my head, but I'm not exactly sure that I can perform it. But as soon as I got home, it was still in my head. And I got it out. I got my guitar, or I could even play it on the piano, but I was like, thank goodness I remembered that song. And I hope I'm not copying somebody else's song accidentally, but I don't think I did, because no one sued us. But also, I didn't know we were going to be a real band, but I just wanted it to be recorded.
Well, we should talk a little bit about that song Swordfish, because on the album it comes out really well for a band that hadn't been jamming that style of music for that long. I mean, it's not your typical Dead Milkmen sound, but you guys play it like you'd been playing it your whole lives. I don't even know what style of music you'd call that, but what were you guys listening to? Where did that
come from? Dave and I listened to a lot of funk music too, and he liked Parliament, Funkadelic. He turned me on to Bootsy Collins. Dave had a much wider breadth of musical knowledge than I did, just from being older. And I was listening to how those bass lines worked, where they kept repeating. I mean, it was just a bass line that just goes on and on. Some of those bass lines could go on for minutes, and for 5 or 6 or 7 minutes. And I just thought, Dave, can we do something it's like that? That's, again, before any lyrics got put onto it, so.
Well, you know what song I loved off that first album, and it might be considered a deep cut, but I don't think I've ever seen you play it live. It's that song, Lucky.
Lucky, we've played live. We've even played it with Dan in the band. We hardly ever play it live now. You're right.
How important was it to Dean to get his specific drum fills down at that time? Because he's one of the more technical drummers, like if you pay close attention to what he's doing. There's that moment in that song where he slows down, hits the cymbals, and then he hits different toms at different times. Like, was that a conscious decision that you guys...
I think we all said we wanted that. That was our improvise. We gave ourselves the freedom to play whatever we wanted to, as long as it fits that rhythm pattern. Like, Dave always played on the strong note, the dom. He would always play on the first beat on that song. But I was allowed to play the second and third beats if I wanted, or not. Or I could play chords, or he could play bass chords. He was allowed to do that. And we did it differently, if we felt like it should be.
Could you give us a little example of that on guitar, like what you're doing?
Like, so, let's see. Wait. after this part. It's just like whatever you play. And sometimes it clashed terribly and sometimes it worked brilliantly.
Yeah. Well, let's just talk about Bitchin' Camaro then. I know you've talked about that a lot, so let's not talk about the long slow part. Like, we know that story, like we know where that came from, but what do you think the drive was to play fast at the time?
We knew Suicidal Tendencies. They have a similar song called Institutionalized, where it goes back and forth. But our song doesn't go back and forth. Our song goes slow, fast, and that's it. Then you're out. But their song's similar because it has the talking section, the spoken section and the fast section. Based on the music I was listening to at the time, that seemed like it was the logical thing.
So we mentioned taking retards to the zoo in my chat with Dan. And I was wondering where you are with that song now. Is it still listenable today? Is it still a fun, silly song?
Yes, I like that song. That's one of the songs that we got lyrics in the mail from Rodney. That was one of the ones that he sent in a certain batch. And Dave saw it and thought it was funny. And Dave pretty quickly just came up with, he had this bass thing, and I was like, oh, that's cool, keep doing that. I can just do these stabs. So it came together really quickly. You could say the music was already written in the lyrics. We just had to extract it. And it was just funny. From what I remember Rodney telling me is that he was inspired by a line in the movie Rocky. The Rocky character was telling Adrian, his girlfriend, take them something like retards like the zoo, take them to the zoo, something like that. I don't know if there's a line like that in the movie, but I don't know if you know the movie Rocky. Philadelphia is known for the movie Rocky now. But back then it was still kind of like a more low-key thing.
Well, you know which song I love to drum along to, but it's damn near impossible? It's Violent School. Because there's so many little intricate moments in the song, like going double snare shots to singles in really hard to predict places. Could you talk a little bit about how the music for that, how something like that comes about in the band?
So the music's kind of all over the place. So I think we're trying too hard to be clever musically, and it probably falls flat. Not one of the best.
No, I think Dean really makes that song because I love how he has his classic, like, double snare shots. Like, he goes, and then he changes to the singles, like, on the verse or the chorus. It sounds like it changes anyway, or maybe it's the music that changes. It's hard to follow because it's like, it makes the song more interesting because you're hitting the one and then the two shot, and then it changes to the two to the one, I think.
I think he just did things because that's the way he thought it should be. And we just thought that's the way it should be, I guess.
Well, I think it's one of the many ingredients that make the album worth coming back to even after all these years. That's probably why it stood the test of time.
Okay. Well, I'm glad you think so.
Well, we have to talk about the Laundromat song. I'm not going to, like, mention every single song from the early days. Like, don't worry about that. But
the Laundromat
song. That's one of my all-time favorites. I said to Dan, the songwriting on this album, it's incredible. It's better than the Beatles. Like, the way that vocal hook comes in, like, I'm not a subtle guy. And then the guitars change to a more typical punk rock thing, which is unlike something the Dead Milkmen would do in the early days. I mean, I wouldn't even expect, like, that to be on a punk band's first album. It's more like a second, third album kind of thing. Like, hey, we've correctly learned how to write songs. Like, here's a vocal hook that's going to have you coming back, listening to the song over and over. Can you talk about where this genius song came from?
This was after I moved into the house that Dave and I moved, the row house, up the street from that house was a laundromat where we washed our clothes. I was literally in the laundromat waiting for my clothes to dry, and I had a pad of paper and a pen, and I wrote down the lyrics. I wrote the lyrics. So that was one of the more unusual for me cases of me writing a lyric with no idea of any music at all. So I came back and met with Dave with these lyrics and only a vague idea of how to put them to music. And he helped me put them to music, and we had the Laundromat song. After my session with Dave, we had a song. So we could go to the next Ed Milkmen rehearsal and say, we have a new song. It's called the Laundromat song. What do you think of it? And Rodney, would Rodney want to sing it or not? And he did. I wasn't thinking, oh, let's try to write a song that somebody will later think is as good as the Beatles, because I wasn't thinking that could possibly be as good as the Beatles.
Well, Joe, I own everything the Dead Milkmen have ever done. I don't have a single thing from the Beatles. So it was you that was responsible for writing that completely amazing vocal hook then?
Yes, I wrote that line. As far as my memory goes, yes. Rodney added some little things to it in his own way. He would invariably change a lyric here and there to suit him. But it was definitely already in the song.
Well, you guys were just too good in 1985, I guess. But it's only a year later when Eat Your Paisley comes out, because bands used to release albums like every year back then. But this album opens up with Where the Tarantula Lives, which is one of the more fun tracks on the album. Is this a deep cut? I don't think I've ever seen you guys play this live, like even back in the early days of the band. Would you happen to remember the guitar riff for it?
Yeah, I remember the guitar riff for it. I played it in my early solo shows. Hollies ruled by midgets, Pope of CBS. Subway cars, with bars, Chicago, and Rudolph S. Samantha Fox on Bridget, President's painted green. Jesus Christ, with frozen ice, but he still makes the scene. Everybody knows me. I know where the tarantula lives. So that was written after Big Lizard album came out. Rodney had the lyrics for it first. He claims he wrote it on a bet with one of the guys from Electric Love Muffin that he could write a song in less than 10 minutes. Now it's just a lyric. He didn't write the music yet, but he wrote the lyrics really quickly. I really like the lyrics because it reminds me of Bob Dylan, somebody I like, and it even mentions tarantula. Although I know Rodney at one point did have a tarantula, a pet tarantula, no, or somebody in our house that I lived in a house with Rodney for a brief time too. At this point in time, had a tarantula, a pet tarantula. I'm not sure if it was Rodney's or our other roommates. Now that I think about it, might have been our other roommate. So I set about to write the music. I tried to write it as quickly as Rodney wrote it, the lyrics, but it probably took me a little longer. But I was also challenging myself with fingerings that I normally wouldn't play so that I could try to be better. So to me, it was sort of a challenge, but I don't know why we don't play it as much now. Maybe it's too folk rocky.
I think it's one of the more fun songs from that album. I would request it to come back. I would like to see that. But Air Crash Museum, that's another great one. This is such a fun album, and like I said, I'm not going to go through every single track, but Air Crash Museum, this is a song that seems to be about a plane crash of celebrities, maybe, and someone stuffing them and putting them in a museum. What's going on with this song, Joe?
It's a Rodney song, so you'll have to defer to him. But I know probably as much as you do. But that's sort of like the sense of humor that I think that reflects more Dave Blood's sense of humor. And I think it's Rodney and Dave, kind of their energy, their humor going together. Maybe I might even say it's Rodney trying to make Dave specifically laugh. It's kind of macabre and in poor taste, you might say, in some circles, to be stuffing people like a taxidermist.
Since a lot of the tracks from Big Lizard existed for a couple of years before the album, were there any songs from Eat Your Paisley that date back before Big Lizard? Was anything lingering from Big Lizard that ended up on this album?
I think we consciously tried not to do too much of that. Bring in my original plan. My original scheme was that half of Big Lizard was really supposed to be Eat Your Pay, the second album, because Big Lizard was only supposed to be a short 10 song thing, but it ended up being a 19 song or 20 song thing. So we already used up all the songs I was going to use for a second album, but we were writing a lot of songs, so we had a lot of new ones. I think the one that dates, that could have been the one song that could have been on Big Lizard was Beach Party Vietnam, because that dated from the Taking Retards to the Zoo air sessions, Beach Party Vietnam. But we did our best not to use the older songs to keep it fresh. Although by the time our third album came out, we did start to mine our older material again, because we needed songs quickly.
Well, my favorite song on this album is I Hear Your Name, and that's the only song that you single to yourself, which is a crime. But is it fair to say you guys were taking inspiration from the post-punk new wave thing that was going on at the time?
It's fair to say, and from my point of view, I didn't know that anybody put a marker as to when punk ended and post-punk began, because I wasn't reading music journalism very much, and I didn't keep up. I only know from retrospect by reading books that somebody stopped punk at a certain year. What year was it? 1978, and then post-punk started. I didn't know that. To me, it was all the same kind of alternative from the crap you hear on the radio normally. I lumped it all together as good. Like, I would put the Talking Heads and Black Flag and the Minutemen and the Replacements even all in the same boat of music. It's hard to separate from the bass. That was one that Dave and I constructed together. So my guitar part intertwines with his bass part, and they don't sound right taken apart, but my part would go. Wait. Across the sea, that's where your hand was taking me. Going to places that I'd never been. I hear your name. Someone's calling your name. Yeah.
That's just wonderful, that is, Joe. But yeah, this is the band's first ever music video, isn't it, for the thing that only eats hippies?
Yeah. We were supposed to do one for Bitch and Camaro, but it never came about. Maybe that's a good thing.
Maybe. But could you talk us through that whole filming process, what that was like? Was it all one day? Was it a week or so?
As far as I remember, it was all day. We rented the space where the studio where Third Story moved to, where we rented the space where we recorded Eat Your Paisley, but not the studio, not the cutting room. There was a garage space that surrounded the studio that the studio owned, because that studio was a former auto garage in Philadelphia. So it was a building that was built to support heavy machinery. And we just also rented some video equipment and lights, and had somebody who knew a little bit more than we did. And I knew a bunch about video too, because I went to college and did that, but it was all pretty DIY. The guy who produced it was our manager's business partner at the time, David Wildman, and he managed a band called Ruin, who were pretty popular in Philly. They were known for being a Buddhist punk rock band, and they always wore white at their shows. I remember, okay, so we probably did it in two different sessions now I think about it. We did the one where we did all the acting out parts, and we had people from our manager Dave's parents' company. His parents had a company that did market research, and some of the people he worked with, children, were in the video too. As the kids that Rodney reads a bedtime story to. So yeah, we all got together, talked about the idea of what we wanted the video to be, figured out the logistics. The second day was we filmed at a actual show space called Revival. It was where a lot of the post-punk bands would play. So that was on a stage. And I think David Wildman had something. I think he was a booking agent at that place too. So he had something to do with there. This guy, who was briefly a business partner with Dave. He unfortunately passed away a few years after that.
Did you guys have a hand in editing this video?
We didn't have a direct hand in edit. We got to see the process. I think David Wildman edited it, maybe with our manager, who also went, like I said, our manager went to school for the same thing I did, the radio, television, film.
Well, this is kind of a fun question for me because I've been wondering this for years. There's a moment in that music video, I guess it's on the bridge when you're singing, where you go like this and you sort of hit Rodney in the face. Was this an accident or was this a gag?
It was a gag. I remember it being a gag.
Can you remember who made those shirts? The Run the Dead Milkmen shirts?
It might have been our friend Chris Kosha, but I don't remember for sure. One of our friends was a stand-up comedian named Chris, but he was also a photographer, so he might have been on set too. But he also worked for another photographer, I'm thinking of George, another photographer, a friend of ours, worked for a screen printing company as a side gig. So we printed our first shirts. I don't know who, I think these were iron-on letters though. I think we might've just ironed them on.
So I was talking to Dad about that song, Take Me Apart. And I said that your screaming vocal part in that song was like the best vocal performance on the album. It like gets into my veins and my blood. It like, it makes me so excited. Like, what could you tell us about the creation of that song?
That's a song that Rodney wrote the lyrics for first. And it was unusual to me because to me, that song, knowing Rodney at the time, I thought, this is, unlike any other songs, this mentions things that are personal to him. I guess I was sort of taken aback, but I saw, oh, he's actually being semi-serious in a song, and if not completely serious. So I took it seriously too and tried to write music that I thought justified the was, you know, could stand up to the lyrics. That's all I remember. And I do remember I'm this is a kind of hackneyed chord progression. This is a chord progression you hear maybe too much, but I thought it fits. I like it. I like the way it works. And I think we did it just, I think if we had done the song any later in our lives, it would have sucked. So we did it just the right point that we could do it without making it suck.
So are you guys playing grindcore on that song, The Fez?
I don't even know. I don't think we knew what grindcore was, but no, I think that song, we were seriously just literally trying to rip off the Buttle Surfers and make as much noise and have as much fun as we can. And Roddy even says that we're ripping off the Buttle Surfers in the middle of the song. That's how we earn our living. Because, I don't know, there's no other band like them. That's a band that we got to open up for before the Big Lizard, was the Buttle Surfers. It was like a, almost a life-changing night. Seeing them perform. Oh, and The Fez is also another song that could have been on Big Lizard, but thankfully wasn't.
So it's 1987. Why did you guys pick an album name that was so difficult for most people to pronounce?
Okay, Fellini. Because Fellini was the director, the Italian director.
Oh, okay.
Movies. It's a Rodney-ism. That name came from Rodney's brain. He's putting, I guess he's like trying to put two different, completely different things together, a Bucky and a Fellini. And is there somebody who possibly could be named that? I don't know. So we created somebody who was that person and named an album after him. We named an album after a fictitious person.
Well, I feel like that album opener is a parody of something. Like, I've heard that somewhere before. Are you ready, Dave?
That's the suite with Ballroom Blitz. Yeah, that was just totally stolen from Ballroom Blitz opening. It's an homage.
So what's the story behind Take Me to a Specialist then? Because I think that's the very first time we ever hear distorted guitar, like on any of the early albums. Whose idea was it to bring that back? Like, it's such a fun little moment to have in the song.
Well, we had a producer named Brian, and he had this idea of bi-amping my guitar, which I liked, and I took that idea on the road with me from then on up until I got a Mesa Boogie amp. So I had my amp, a clean amp, and he said, combine that with another amp where the amp is being distorted. I guess I developed an aversion to any kind of pedal. I didn't use any pedals up until then to make distortion, because I guess I just didn't want to learn how to use them properly or didn't know. Like I said, Dean couldn't tell when I was switching chords, but we were getting amp distortion. So he had this really old amp. It was like from the 40s or 50s. I don't know. It just got that insane distortion. I love the sound. It sounds like metal on metal, kind of teeth grating distortion, but it was just coming from the amp. There was no pad. It was just the amp being overdriven. And so we combined that, those two. It was just me playing once, but the sounds was being split and going through a clean amp in one room, and in another room, another closet, totally separated from it. It was going in this other amp. If you just heard the one distorted amp by yourself, you might not even be able to tell what notes it was playing sometimes. But when you combine it with the clean amp, it sounds brilliant. And that was the producer's contribution to how to record on Bucky Fellini. And I liked it so much that I then got a second amp. I got two amps, a clean one and one that I could easily distort, and had an AB switch. That was my first ever pedal that I had in a show. And I'd stomp on that to turn the other amp, the distortion amp, on. So the clean amp is going on through the whole show, but the distortion amp would come in when I needed distortion. And the sound engineer at the front would know how to mix it properly.
Yeah. Were you guys sitting in on the mixing sessions for these early albums?
We sat on the mixing session for the first album. The second album, from my memory, is that not all the band wanted to be on all the mixing sessions, but Dean and I were on some of them, and some of them we weren't. It was like, because we lived just down the block, just a few blocks away from the studio. All of us were living in West Philly back at the time. The studio was in West Philly, and we could go in when we wanted to, or, you know, we didn't have to stay the whole time. The other ones in Texas, we are kind of there because we don't live in Texas. We don't have cars, our own cars, so we were kind of like trapped. But I don't remember having a bad time. I enjoyed it. I enjoyed having my ears there. And you also get to have a say in things. But we learned early on that not to get too concerned until you're close to the final mix. But yeah, we were always part of the mixing process from then on. I mean, we worked with a producer who didn't want us to be, for Soul Rotation, they didn't want us to be at all. in the mix. Too many cooks spoil the broth, he says. So we weren't privy to that, but we still had, we could veto a mix and have him try to do it again.
Did you remember which instruments you preferred to have the loudest in the mix back then?
I, of course, wanted guitars to be loud, but you couldn't put, like, you couldn't, it was always the vocals. There was always a push. I wanted the vocals to be loud enough that you could hear the words, and then Roddy might say that it's too loud, uncharacteristically of him. You have to bring the vocals back, but it just didn't work. Like, we would try it, and the song would sound flat. You have to have the vocals up loud. Like, if you compare us to other punk bands of the day, our vocals are really, really present, but they have to be that way because of our style. I remember having that argument. I tended to win a lot of the arguments that we had in the early days and then lose a lot of the ones in the later days, but that's the way it is.
Well, could you play Watching Scotty Die for us?
I probably could. And this is a song that was early. This is a song that could have been on Big Lizard too, but didn't make the cut for that album, but made the, finally got on our third album. And this started with the lyric of Rodney's. I've got a kid, his name is Scott. He's going blind and his blood just will not clot. The doctor's line in rows to stick to his of Scotty's nose. There is a field where Scotty used to play until Arthur Orange number 42 was dumped in it one day. I think it's so funny. Watching Scotty die, just me and God. Watching Scotty die. The chemical plant across the street, the leaves are steam, their colors are white sheets. It's happening for years. Now mom crying rainbow tears. One day our dog went out to play instead of gray. He came back colored yellow. Chemical man says stay mellow. It happens all the time. Now Scotty's skin is lined. I think it's so funny. I laugh until I cry, just me and God. Watching Scotty die, just me and God. Scotty die.
Amazing. So you say Rodney wrote the opening lyrics to that song?
Yeah. And then he never finished it. He just had a couple couplets. And I always thought it was a curious song. I didn't know about the inspiration came from a Bobby Goldsboro song at the time called Watching Scotty Grow. I just saw the lyrics written down on his unlined notebook paper and asked Rodney when he was going to finish that song because I thought it was cool. And he said, oh, that song? I'm not going to finish that song. Said well, do you mind if I take the reins on it and try to finish? Go ahead. Do whatever you want with it. So I finished it and wrote the music to it.
So that was written before Big Lizard?
Yes. This was in the period of time where I was living in the row house that Dave and I found to rent near where that laundromat was that inspired the laundromat song. So yeah, it was written before Big Lizard. We played it in our early shows before Dean's Dream was a song, as a song to give Rodney a vocal break. He would always say, "Okay, Joe Jack's gonna sing the next song," and it would always be "Watching Scotty Die." So when we came up with Dean's Dream as a song for me to sing, that dislodged Watching Scotty Die and became our song, because Dean's Dream was a lot fit a lot better with our punk, by then growing into the hardcore kind of sound than Watching Scotty Die did, because we could still keep up the pace, the energy of the set, and I'd still sing a song.
Yeah. Well, I feel like there's a couple of songs that happened in between 86 and 87, like that recording of Stupid Marianne, the clean one that ended up on one of the Enigma comps, I think.
Doesn't understand that one.
Yeah.
And man, that was the song that preceded Big Lizard 2, that I recorded on my own at my parents' house on their old piano. And that was inspired by me seeing in the movie theater. It was like a ska music festival, and I can't remember. It was a bunch of shorts and stuff, and one of the shorts was video, what we call videos now, would be on MTV. Back then, we saw them in the movie theater, of Madness. And I'd never seen Madness before. I never even heard of them before seeing them in this movie, in the movies. And I wanted to emulate their that fast ska sound. So the early recording of it was totally different than the way the Dead Milkmen ended up doing it, because it definitely had, on the piano, it was doing the upbeats, just like Madness would do. So it's kind of like a Madness ripoff, but not really of any of their songs, just the style that I was hearing and trying to replicate. And I looked all over record stores for that song that was in the movie, and it wasn't My Girl's Mad at Me. It wasn't. I kept buying singles because I didn't know the name of it. So I grew. I had a quite a nice Madness singles collection just trying to find that song.
Do you remember if that was supposed to go on the Eat Your Paisley record? Was that why it was originally resurfaced?
Now, yeah, why? So that ended up, where did it end up? It ended up getting on a compilation.
Yeah, I think I'm sure it's 1987.
Yeah, we recorded it when we were recording the Bucky Fellini album, I'm pretty sure, because the producer, Brian, had this weird concept that first takes were somehow magical to him. He would always try to capture us doing first takes of something and get something. So he did get us doing the first take of our cover of Big Time Operator that way, which was I thought was horrible, but he said there's so much magic, and he made us use the first take. He wouldn't want us to practice too much of a song. So to warm up the studio and to get all the settings, he wanted us to play songs that we weren't going to record. So we would have to go back into our memories and get old songs. And that was one of them. So that wasn't even meant to be on any album, but it got recorded because he recorded us doing these things. And in fact, there's the Smoking Banana Peels single, B-sides, all of those were, we rehearsed by the, that was our first album with him was Bucky Fellini. Our second album was Beelzebubba. So knowing that he would do that, we rehearsed a lot of, we brought back a lot of our old songs and brushed them off, so that we were like, he's going to ask us to record play these old songs. Let's just get a bunch of them ready so that they're recorded for posterity, because we're never going to record them again. And that's one of them. We were never going to work on Stupid Marianne and make it a real song. It just was a song that got given to the Enigma Records as a non available on any album track.
Yeah. Well, we should talk a little bit about the sound quality of this one, because Dan says it sounds like it was recorded in a silo. I'm saying it's very sonic, very electronic. Of course, it helps you have that dance track, Instant Club Hit. Look, that's the sound I think of when I think of this album. Mm-hmm. Could you shed some light on why it sounds this way? I think it sounds great, but, you know, it's very different to the first two.
To me, that studio in San Marcos, it's called the Firehouse, was the first real studio that looked like what my imagination of a studio was from what I've seen in television shows and movies. I mean, it was really clean and antiseptic almost. The other two studios were grungier. The first studio we recorded in just looked like someone's attic that had recording equipment put into it and some instruments. And the second studio was, like I said, it seemed like an auto garage because that's what it was. And they threw down a carpet in it and made it look, it kind of had a funky hippie vibe to it. Because I think the owner was an old hippie that cut off his hair and became a businessman. But the third studio was the first one that looked like, oh, this is what real studios are like. It had all the wood panel kind of thing. It had those sound absorbers that are made specifically to be sound absorbers. They're not anything else. It's not egg crates stapled to the wall or anything. This is like a real studio, really constructed to be a recording studio, tuned and everything. And Brian picked it out because he liked the sonic sound of the studio, but Brian was against using any effects. He wanted all the sounds to be room sounds, to be the sound, all reverb to be room reverb, not effects that you put on to it. Like in the other recordings, it's a Varus. They got the sound, but they blended everything with reverb. But he wanted everything to blend naturally. So if we did an overdub, it had to be in the room where the drums were and mic just so that you can get, it would sound like it was really being recorded at the same time. I don't know if that helps explain the difference, but that was his approach to recording. Now, when we came to mixing, we had to twist his arm to get actual contrived reverb put into it because it was sounding too flat in some parts, and he didn't want that. He wanted it to all be natural, and that's what he was aiming for, and that's what he kind of reached. That's kind of basically what he achieved in that recording. It was mixed in a different studio, but it was all recorded in the same space.
So were you guys happy with the final product, like, once it came out?
I was more than happy with it. I was really happy that he got other musicians that he knew from town, from Austin, to augment some of the songs. I had no idea that he was going to do that. Mm. I mean, he said he was going to try some things. Would we be open to that sort of experimentation? Mm. I thought it was cool to have the violin. I liked the way he played the lap steel on Watching Scotty Die. It brought it up a level I didn't expect it to be. It really made it sound real. And I was thinking, maybe this is how people make recordings for real. Because it's not how we made our first two albums.
Did you guys get any shit for the art fag thing?
I think we got more shit for mention in AIDS in Bitchin' Camaro than we got for Art Fag in Instant Club It. And I also had nothing to do with Instant Club It. That song came about in the studio. I didn't contribute to it except to whirl around a plastic tube that someone had bought as a toy, and it made a whirling, whistling sound.